These recommendations, more especially the one that agents shouldn't be allowed in at the hotels of the national team, is very embarrassing to the agents per se. You know, never mind the agency business. You know, it's painting a very dark picture around the operations of the agents, around the national team coach and so forth. You know, so therefore, I'm sure it's not me, it's not Glyn only who, you know, is concerned by the entire situation. You know, I cannot expect myself to be a prisoner in my own country. If I want to go to a hotel, I will go and sleep as long as I can afford. Whether or not the national team coach is there or the national team is camping in the same hotel, it's none of my business. You know, it is my right, you know, for example. So again, I'm saying I don't understand this finding. You know, to me, it doesn't make sense.
So you guys are going to defy it?
Well, I can afford a hotel anywhere where the national team coach can camp. You can take them to Paris, I'll go if I have to. You know, you can take them to Germany, I'll afford that hotel. Locally, I afford all hotels, thanks God. So therefore, I see no one stopping me from if I want to. I've never done it. I've never slept in the same hotel as the national team. I know that other agents have camped in the same hotel as the national team during tournaments, for the duration of the tournament. You know, I've never done it. But should I want to do it, no one can stop me.
I find it very strange that the association doesn't want agents to be in the team hotel, because as agents, I think we have the same goal as the Football Association. I'd like to hope that we've got the same goal as the Football Association, and that is to make sure that the players are happy off the field in order for them to be able to progress and do the business on the field. And I think what will probably end up happening is if they stop the agents from coming to see the players, and the players do want to see the agents, the players are going to then leave the hotel to go and see the agents. So, you know, for me, there seems to be a total lack of trust between SAFA and the coach and SAFA and the players. And if there's a breakdown in trust, and I think there's a big problem in South African football. I think they need to be dealing with the issues and dealing with them in the right way. You know, we've all got to have a common goal. And the other thing which concerns me is that the very same association who wants to ban agents' involvement in the team and ban agents having a relationship with coaches and players and stopping them from coming are the same people who are contacting us when they need help with the clubs and help with the players. We interact daily with the clubs. We interact daily with the players, and especially with the foreign-based players. And SAF is continuously phoning us to try and help with this and help with that. So, you know, they must be very careful what they're saying in terms of how they're going to be dealing with things, because, you know, you can't have one set of rules and guidelines when you don't want something and another set of rules and guidelines when you do want something. I think this issue hasn't been clearly thought out.
The findings of the Arendse Commission do not make sense to me. Reading at the findings and the recommendations made by the Arendse Commission, it is clear to me that they found a number of wrongs in the operations and happenings around the national team coach, you know, such that they recommended that certain things should not happen ever again. So to me, clearly they do find out that certain things had happened which in their view were wrong, and therefore they must stop them from happening. That being the case, I don't understand how then they found the national team coach not to be guilty of any allegation. I'm not suggesting that he was guilty. I'm just saying this finding or outcome doesn't make sense.
Quite surprised that on the one hand they find the coach innocent, and to be honest, I believe the coach is innocent. You know, I know the coach, I have a relationship with the coach. In the last two camps in the Chan tournament, which is the one that's under scrutiny, I had one player in the team, Lerato Chabangu. And in this current team, the next team for the tournament in New Zealand, or the games in New Zealand and Australia, I also have only one player. But for me, as an agent, I've got to respect the coach's decision to select the players that he believes are going to do the best job for him. I may have five players that I believe are better than in the current squad, but that's the players that the coach believes in, and that's the players that the coach believes will get the end results. And ultimately, if the coach doesn't get the end results and the results aren't good for the coach, then he'll get sacked. So for me, I would never interfere and never, you know, push certain players and certain agendas in the situation. But I find it surprising that on the one hand they clear him, and then on the other hand they put recommendations in place to take that will be put in place for the future. So if you are saying that there's no problem, then why are you putting causes in place to stop similar situations from happening in the future if there aren't situations?
Of course, you know, for the good and the bad of it, I think there has been. We have heard it before. If you look at the again at the recommendations by the commission, you can see that they found some wrongs in some doings of the agents, you know, who was around the national team coach. Clearly, they did. I don't care that they've now come out to say the coach has been found not guilty of all these allegations. Otherwise, if indeed he was found not guilty or they saw no wrong in everything that was brought forward, you know, they wouldn't have made these recommendations. So clearly, I think now the agents' operations around the national team coaches will be under scrutiny. I think it will be for the good of the game. We have seen it in this country, coaches being influenced by their agents in their selections. We have seen in this country the national team being dominated by one particular stable. You know, when you look at it, you know...
So it's true that this thing is happening?
Look, I would say so. You know that there is something that has been... It's not for me to say so, but you look at the recommendations of the commission, you can see that they found so many wrongs and yet they found the coach not guilty. It doesn't make sense.
Do you think this is the turning point?
Yeah, well, for the benefit of the game, it's going to be, you know, the turning point of things. I think things will happen way better. I've been asked, let me just put an example. I've been asked about players in my stable. One particular one, Eric Matoho, very young, 23 years old, one for the future. He's got the right credentials for a center back. He's got height. He's got agility. He's playing well for Kaizer Chiefs. In all the games, he started for Kaizer Chiefs, leading to their winning of the championship last season. And even this season, Kaizer Chiefs has not been conceding goals, right? So you have this player who is continuously being ignored by the national team coach, you know? So, and then you look again, maybe players who are playing ahead of him will find a 32-year-old Thabo Ntete, you know, and in the very same breath, when announcing the team, the coach would go as so far as saying that he's building for the future, he's called youngsters, and so, you know. So then, when you look at the Matoho situation, you listen to what the coach is saying, it doesn't make sense. I'm not suggesting that he's being in that decision, he's been influenced or anything, or maybe it's, of course, maybe Ntete is a better player than Matoho. I'm not sure. I'm looking at Matoho's statistics achievements compared to a 32-year-old Ntete. Even if Ntete was a better player, when you say you're building for the future, how on earth would you ignore Matoho, a player such as Eric Matoho, who has played in derbies in front of 90,000? His big match temperament, his pedigree has been proven, you know. So really, it casts some doubt. But look, we are human beings. We all believe we've got our opinion is better than the national team coach's opinion. So when I got asked those questions, I always respected the coach's opinion. And in fact, I refused to answer.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I'm an agent, and the agency under scrutiny is competitor to mine, but I genuinely don't believe that. If the agency has a number of players, the agency has a very, very large number of players, you will have a lot of good players. If you represent 100 or 150 players, whatever it is, you will have a pool of good players amongst the 150 players. And if you're going to choose a squad of 20 players in a national team, it's going to be representative of the number of players you have. So I genuinely don't believe that that's the situation. And ultimately, the coach will be held responsible for the results. So if he's selecting certain players from certain agencies and the results aren't forthcoming, then he'll be held accountable for that.
To say a coach need not be represented by an agent, you know, to me, actually, I find it a little bit bizarre. Look, it is the coach's constitutional right to be represented by a person of choice. I need not say it. It is there. It is enshrined in our constitution. You know, he is a member of the public. He, you know, when a coach is to be engaged by the National Association, he would be interacting with his prospective employers. I wouldn't expect him, you know, to represent himself. You know, these people are not trained in this sphere. You know, they are not lawyers. They are just coaches. All they know is to do the game of football in the field of play, maybe. You know, and therefore, not too many of them can go out there and strike best deals for themselves. So I'm not saying this to defend the position of the agents. I'm just saying I think that particular rule or principle or whatever, you know, I think it goes to the root of infringing some of the fundamental constitutional rights of the national team coaches. And therefore, I'm short of saying it's very wrong in my view.
I find it very difficult, very strange that you're going to stop a coach from having an agent. Most of the top coaches in the world and the reputable coaches all have representation. So to stop a coach from coaching your national team because he's an agent, if he has an agent, I'd be very surprised if that is followed through with. I personally don't represent coaches, but there are agents that do represent coaches, and I think they'll find it very challenging to find a coach who's prepared to come here without representation.
Look, I would have done so. Actually, if he wasn't comfortable, I was going to give a statement, maybe on his behalf, a statement endorsed by him, and maybe got an affidavit out of him. I'm saying this because there was a lot of cloud surrounding Itumeleng Khune, more especially his exclusion in the Chan game against Nigeria, where a few days thereafter, if I'm not wrong, he was declared fit, and in fact, he continued and played for Kaizer Chiefs soon thereafter, and they won quite a significant number of matches with him, at the helm of that team. Was for the national team in that critical game, which we lost 3-1 through goalkeeper blunders, two of them at least, he was declared unfit. So therefore, I think he was a key witness, and being his agent, I would have really insisted on him testifying in this. I think he was very, his testimony was very critical. It's unusual. Look, we follow international trends. I've never heard of it internationally in the best countries of the world that have gone as so far as winning the World Cups and so forth, having sort of players contracted to the national association, and I think it will cause some exclusion to some of the deserving players or up and coming players. I don't know, actually I'm not sure as to how rugby and cricket they balance it out. But again, if you would go closer to rugby and cricket, you may find that there are up-and-coming talents that are excluded because of this signing or contracting of national team players, and therefore they don't get the opportunity because the number, the target number, maybe 30 must be contracted, would have been filled by those who would have already been signed. And therefore, it will never work for football.
Rugby and cricket have a smaller, more established pool from which they're selecting players, so they can have a situation. But form in football is very different to rugby and cricket. And when one has players on the contract, and I mean, the problem is that the Football Association at the moment can't pay the players, and they're not under contract. There's always financial issues, and players haven't been paid for games, etc., etc. How is that going to be any better when they're contracting them? Because obviously, when they're contracting them, they're going to be paying them some sort of a monthly remuneration. And at the end of the day, the players are employed by the clubs, and that's where they get their monthly remuneration. And I think it's very, very different in football. And I think it would be very short-sighted to contract the players. One could contract them on a camp basis, and perhaps when they're going to certain camps, once the team has been selected. But if you're going to contract a pool of players, you're almost in a sense then forced to select from that pool of players, and what type of messaging is it sending out to the other players that aren't contracted and who gain form at certain periods. I just think people need to think before they make comments.